Well, hi, Section 14. Here I am again. Just watching a beautiful doe come very slowly up my driveway, almost like it wants to tell me something. You know, you haven't seen much of me this week, and I haven't seen much of anybody, really. So much going on. HLC visit. College had to survive that on Monday and Tuesday, and I went to four of those sessions. That trimmed my teaching down a little bit. A lot, actually. And then weather, and then more weather. So here I am with a Good Friday edition of our class. And happy to be back at it. I feel a little bit rusty. And before I... Basically, I only taught two classes this week, but before I do anything today, I want to say, for those of you for whom it matters, for those of you who are observing it or will be observing it, just have a wonderful Easter on Sunday. I'm going to have my mother, is going to be brought up by my son and daughter-in-law and their little dog, Wilbur. And, you know, she's 94 in May, so, you know, when your parent gets that old, you start thinking, you know, not morbid thoughts, but, you know, you wonder, is this... Could this be my mother's last Easter? And if she lives to 100, that'll be no problem. I hope you're well, and this is that really, really busy time of year. You know, I had the idea that I would just make one video for you, but I think I've got enough thinking here that it should be divided across a couple of videos. I don't want anything to get too long for you. So I've got a brief poem by a poet named Linda Pastan, who's new to me. I got a lot of poets on my Facebook, and that's part of what I want to talk about today. And basically what we do is we just keep showing each other poems. We're English teachers who can't stop making assignments for each other. Then I think the bulk of what this video is going to be about is reflecting on some relatively new thinking for me. I want to call it chain reaction thinking. And it has to do with the idea that, you know, you think you're a smart person, like you think you know what's going on in the world, and then every once in a while, this is my main experience that I want to report to you, suddenly you're like, wait, what? How do I not know that? And I talked about this problem that I'll outline for you very carefully here, as carefully as I can, with another poet online, David Baker, who's recently retired from a long career of teaching. He's just getting going as a poet, though. David Baker helped me. He's like, I told him his problem. He's like, look, just because you teach in a college doesn't mean you know everything. You know a thing or two, but that's about it, no matter how brilliant you are. And then I've got a follow-up thought about the West, the theme of the West, that I've already talked to you about. And then we'll move on with the second video later on in the afternoon. Hopefully, I'll get both of these done before I take my wife out to dinner this evening, for Good Friday evening. So anyway, here's a poem by Linda Pastan. Pastan, I'm not even sure if I'm pronouncing it correctly. It's about wonder, and I cannot wait. 1 week from today, I'll be introducing Maya C. Popa in the Chalberg for my third poetry reading of the year. And I'm excited about that for a lot of reasons, and one of them is that I've already mentioned that she has a tremendous interest in the relationship between poetry and wonder. And that's what her second dissertation is all about, and wonder's a big deal to me. Okay, imaginary conversation. Linda Pastan. You tell me to live each day as if it were my last. This is in the kitchen, where before coffee, I complain of the day ahead. That obstacle race of minutes and hours, grocery stores and doctors. But why the last? Why not live each day as if it were the first? All raw astonishment. Eve rubbing her eyes awake that first morning, the sun coming up like an ingenue in the east. You grind the coffee with the small roar of a mind trying to clear itself. I set the table, glance out the window where dew has baptized every living surface. Anyway, chain reaction thinking, I don't know if I would call it sloppy, but I love the interconnectedness of things. There is an order, there is a structure to the world, if you ask me, and it seems once in a while that the world tries to reveal that structure to us. You got to pay attention, you got to listen closely, and I'll just spell it. Here's how the idea went. Last weekend, a great poet who I hosted a few years ago the Pulitzer Prize winning Peter Blakian, who's an Armenian guy. I gave him a friend request on Facebook a while ago. I'm stumbling with my words. I'm rusty. Didn't teach enough this week to speak properly. And I love this man. We had a fantastic couple, 3 days together. We became friends. But it took him a minute before he actually accepted my Facebook request. And when I saw that he did that, for some reason I felt compelled to find his book, Ziggurat. And I had some of his books before he came, but when he got back to Colgate University in New York, where he teaches, which some people think is the most beautiful university in the entire country, it was important for him that I had this book, and so he sent it to me from his office. Probably had, you know, the English administrative assistant do it there, because that is an elite place. And I picked up this book when I thought about Peter Blakey, and I went, wow, Ziggurat, what the heck is that? And then I did a search on it, and I'm like, what? How did I not know this? Ziggurat was an extraordinary structure in ancient Iraq, I think erected by a king, a definite king whose name is slipping me right now. And it's basically ancient Iraq's equivalent to the pyramids in Egypt. It also makes me think about the Tower of Babel as built in the Bible. And that makes me a little bit uneasy, because that is a project that shouldn't have been started. That's, I think, a modern fable for our times. Tower of Babel, the same thing. People get together and they build a structure thinking that they can get to heaven without the help of God. I think that's what a few people are up to on this planet of misfortune right now. But I just am scratching the surface of this, and I learned about this incredible building, which has been rebuilt a few times. It's huge, as you can see. I wondered, wow, did they have any literature there? Well, yeah, duh, they had literature there, apparently. And I don't know how I've got to stop saying this. How did I not know this? It is possible that this is exactly where literature began. On other days, I've told you that for me, literature begins in a garden, the Garden of Eden. But, you know, facing facts, it probably goes back a little bit further than the story in Genesis that I believe in. And at this incredible temple, when there was a city surrounding it called Ur, apparently there was a woman there, a priestess, who more or less invented literature. And I was astonished to then dig into that a little bit, and I found this poem called Hymn to Inanna, translated by Jane Hirschfield. And now I'm super excited because Jane Hirschfield is coming this fall, and I'm going to host her. And she has a translation, a collection of translations out called Women in Praise of the Sacred, and 43 centuries of sacred poetry by women. And I'm going to order this book for my classical mythology class this fall, and it's going to be fantastic. And then what will be great is that people can come to the reading and get their book signed by Jane Hirschfield. So in thinking about this, I started mucking around. The only class I got to teach this week at CLC, the other one was at Staples. Monday morning, I got to my classroom early in a high state of excitement, because what I wanted to do was scratch out on the board long before my students got there. I love getting there early, you know, get the coffee going. And I've already drunk coffee by then, but get the green tea going and get the lights on and get some classical music humming. And basically, I went to my blackboard, as you can see, and I scratched out as many different genres of writing as I possibly could think of. And then later in the day, my humanites came in, as I jokingly call them, and they came in and looked at that list, and they were kind of getting a vibe from it, vibing on it, as we would say. And then I said, hey, help me. What am I missing? Well, then they threw more items on, and they're kind of above and below my original list that I started in the morning. And I just want to kind of add to some thinking that we did earlier in the semester, because this is Comp 1. I told you in Comp 1, our Comp 1, what I tell all Comp 1s, that there's four modes of modern writing: self-expressive, persuasive, expository or informative, and when we are really going for it, we try to be literary. But then when you go in within those modes and start breaking it down, it really gets interesting. Look at all the ways that we write. And I'll repeat an idea, and then we'll move on. I told you earlier that writing is unnatural, but that's a good thing because we're super good at the unnatural. We are super good at the artificial. And this is a way I never thought, even a few years ago. The act of writing is a technological feat, right? That's why I give out pens on the first day of every class. That's why I gave some of you sweet students pens when you came to find me during Bridges Career Fair Day. And just to flesh out the idea just a little bit more, and then I'll let this go. When we hear the word technology, we can think of something that was made out of plastic or glass or steel. But technology could be defined, I read this somewhere, technology could be defined as anything man-made, human-made, let's make it gender inclusive, start again. Technology is anything human-made that solves a problem, that solves a particular kind of problem. Now, all those genres that you saw on the board, I haven't, I've never written a nursery rhyme. I've never written a space opera. I don't even know what that is. But there are genres there that I've touched. And writing solves problems, man. You got to know this right now. If you can write, you can make things happen. Rhetoric is a technology, too. So just, there's a couple fast examples. Years ago, when I fell in love, and you're going to fall in love more than once. Somebody should probably give you the heads up on that. But when I fell in love with my wife, I had a problem. That was a problem that needed to be solved. Why? Because she was going out with a good friend of mine, like a really good friend of mine. And it was a social scandal at St. Ben's in 1982, et cetera, because the friend group got all riled up. And at the end of that, my senior year, actually the end of my fifth year there, because I'm so stupid, it took me 5 years to get my 3 undergrad degrees. At the end of that year, my wife, my future wife, thank goodness, Jesse Johnson, she said to both me and this guy named John, who I'm not exactly in contact with anymore, he's still mad at me, she said, okay, I need space from you guys. I need a break. And I said, okay, I'll give you a break. I'm going to hitchhike all the way to Alaska. I'll come back in the fall and I want an answer. Are you going to enter into a story with me or not? Well, how did I solve that problem? I wrote her one love letter after another from a rain-soaked tent in Seward, Alaska, in southeast in the Kenai Peninsula. Every single week, I wrote her a letter, and that solved the problem. That carried the day. I defeated him with writing. I defeated him, let's put it this way, I earned the hand of my wife with a technology called a love letter. If I don't do that, my sons don't exist. Maybe I wouldn't exist. The second example of the three one I put before you, grant writing. What kind of problem does grant writing solve? We don't have enough poetry in the public sphere, and we have to bring it out into the public sphere. So I write one grant after another to create poetry readings. It solves a bunch of problems, right? I would call it a problem that we don't have enough beauty in our lives. I would call it a problem that we don't create enough spaces, public spaces, where a voice can be heard, representing a different perspective. And grant writing solves that problem every time, and I'm working on another one for May 15th, and I just got another one, like I told you. No sense bragging about that anymore. And I'm thinking now of a young man named Rafael Cadillo, who was one of my Staples Motley students from last year. What's his problem? He doesn't exactly have enough money to go to college, so I keep reworking this letter of recommendation for him for scholarships for different schools, and I just redid it again because he wants to apply to the college, St. Thomas University's Catholic Latino Studies program. And I hope what I wrote for him will solve that problem of needing some funding to become an educated person. And I think this is interesting. Maybe you do too. Final thing today, last thing today. We talked about the metaphor of the West, the theme of the West in American literature, which is absolutely huge. And quick story. I showed this to my Staples kids yesterday because I was finishing up the theme there before I get to the next one, which is the tension between the Romantic Age and the Realistic Age. Themes in American literature, that's what I'm up to. regarding the West, I'll just tell you a fast story. And I'm in the exact room where it happened, although it's completely configured in a different way. When my boys were little, one of the things that my wife was on was something called the Baylor Plan, which meant that each weekend she either worked 3 8-hour evening shifts, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or 2 12-hour shifts, Saturday and Sunday from 7 to 7. And that was hard for her, but it was also great at the same time because it meant that on Sunday night, she had the whole week ahead to homeschool our boys, and she homeschooled them all the way to St. John's. So the paradoxical childhood my children had was based on different parenting styles. So during the week, they were with my wife, and she was very overprotective. She knew exactly where they were at every minute of the day. Well, when she headed up the long driveway that I just saw that deer come down, and where is that deer now? Whether it was Friday afternoon or when we'd wake up on Saturday morning, we'd say, it's boy weekend. And basically what that meant is that their not overly protective father was at the wheel. And that's when I dispensed knives, fire, I ordered them to climb trees, etc. I'd get out there and get dangerous because I wanted to have them have the same reckless, feral childhood that I had when I was a boy. And the back and forthness of that, they just sort of adjusted to. And they appreciated both. And once my wife came home one night, it was a Saturday night, and we were in this room on the other side of the room, big bowl of popcorn, iMac out, and we were watching a John Wayne Western. She said, what are you doing? I said, we're watching a Western. Okay. She said, why? I said, well, we've been watching Westerns for weeks. I just want to get the mythology of the West in them. She said, I'm going to sit down, and I want to watch it with you. I said, no, you should jump in the shower. You're tired. No, I want to see what you're up to. So she sits down in the middle of John Wayne's Chisholm, and the scales kind of fell from my eyes. Yeah, great American Western, John Wayne, great American hero, great Hollywood star, inspired so many people. Well, tiny problem with Chisholm, probably like many of John Wayne's Westerns, and I'm not getting all woke on you, don't worry. At least the movie, let's stick with the movie we were watching. Until she sat down there and I had another terministic screen to see it through, as in her eyes, I didn't really realize that I was showing boys, my sons, a movie that was completely denigrating pretty much everyone possible except white advanced white males like me. Native Americans, trashed. Women, cheapers, cripes, geisha girl prostitutes, right? In the next scene that we watched. And this scene where we've got a Mexican guy with a complete ethnic stereotype. He's got a bottle of whiskey from the bottle. He's got a bandolier of bullets around him, his torso. And we get this confrontation right here. So just take this, give this a look, and I'll see you very soon.
How do we work this?
I'm going down there. The rest of you cover me with your long guns.
I said I heard you, Mr. Chisholm, but I ain't the rest of
you. Hey, welcome, my friend.
My name's Chisholm. Those animals are mine.
Oh, there must be some mistake here.
You made it.
No, Chisholm. You make the mistake. You don't bring enough men with you.
Mr. Chisholm said to stay here and cover him with our long guns.
Never was much good with a long gun.
But I tell you what. We have a long way to go in horses. A lot of trouble. So if you want these horses, I sell them to you. Did you bring some gold with you?
No.
Silver?
Just lead.
No, you can't buy anything with lead. Oh, well, I guess I have to kill you and take your horses too.